Everlasting life is precious. Everlasting life is precious. It's not just something that God is just going to give away. You're going to have to make sacrifices for it. You're going to have to go down the straight and narrow path. What are you willing to give up? And think about the things that you're not willing to give up. Is it worth it? Is it worth retaining that sin within your own self and within your camp? It's time to give God one full chance at Him leading you and guiding you. It's time to surrender to Him. It's time to give up every single sin in your life. When we read Joshua 7:13, Lord help me tonight. It says, "Oh Israel," this message is for you, "you cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the cursed thing from around you." I need y'all help tonight. Does anyone know, do you know what's in the Valley of Achor? Have you heard of the Valley of Achor? Are you familiar with what's in the Valley of Achor? What if you knew the exact day the Lord will return? Would you live holy until you see His face? Or you live in sin, get away with as much as you can until He returns? If you knew the exact day the Lord would return, would you YOLO, live it up, then try to get saved the last day or the last minute? Before the Lord returns, will you risk ending up in the Valley of Achor? Or do you really love God and want to please Him? 1 hour before the Lord returns, will you be trying at that moment to clean your hands and purify your heart? Even if you make the poor decision to wait until the week before the Lord returns, will you have enough time to get your heart pure? Is a week, a month, is a year? How much time does it take to get your heart pure? Because we know from Scripture a purified heart is necessary for salvation. And this is a process. This process begins with you accepting the fact, I don't have a pure heart. You have to start there. You got to start with, I am a sinner and I need God to save me from my sins. Because of our unpurified heart, we do things, we crave things, we like things that are sinful. We got to get God to forgive us for those things. Our actions and our behavior is a manifestation of what's already in our heart, what's already in our wicked heart. That's why the Bible says in 1 Peter 1:22, "Seeing you have purified your souls," your heart, "in obeying the truth." If you are wondering how to get a pure heart, let me read it again. It says, "Seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth." That's how you purify your heart. You obey the truth. You have to hear the word of God and then obey it. God loved you so much. He loved you so much, He made it real simple. Obey His word. You want to hear something sad? You want to hear something sad? God said, "I have spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people, which walks in a way that was not good. After their own thoughts, they do what they want to do." I don't want that to be me. In verse 3, it says, "A people that provokes me to anger continually to my face." Why would anybody intentionally provoke God? God said, "For my people is foolish. They don't really know me. They are stupid children. And they have no understanding. They are wise to do evil, but to do good, they have no knowledge." That means we have a way to do anything we want to do. We can find money to send from somewhere. We can figure out how to get off work early to do whatever we want to do. We can find ways to justify sin. But what if you use that same talent? God said, "My people don't have knowledge. They don't have the knowledge to do good." When we get to James chapter 2, verse 24, he says, "You see then how that by works, the stuff you do, is a man justified. You see by what you do, a man is justified, and not by faith only. Believing God ain't enough." Verse 25, wasn't Rahab the harlot justified by works when she received the messengers and had sent them another way? Verse 26, for as the body without the spirit is dead. Without your spirit, your body is dead. That same way. So faith without doing something is also dead. Believing God ain't enough. You got to do something. You remember Rahab? Okay, let me tell you about Rahab. What I don't understand is many times the Bible doesn't mention a woman's name. Why not just call her Rahab? Why label her? Was there a bunch of Rahabs and they just decided, okay, so this one here was a prostitute. So we need to make sure we continuously call her Rahab and then label her by her sin. Let me tell you all about Rahab. Joshua sent two men to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, including Jericho. Because remember, after Moses died, Joshua was given the charge to take God's people into the land God promised. He promised us after we left Egypt. Okay, so the two spies, they went and they came into the prostitute's house. Her name was Rahab. They stayed there, and these two spies, they wasn't slick, because somebody saw him spying and they reported him to the king. So then the king of Jericho, he sent soldiers to Rahab, and he said, hey, those two spies that came to your house, we saw them come to your house. They're gathering information about the entire country. So Rahab took the two spies and she hit them. She took them somewhere and she hit them. And she said, they two men came, but I don't know where they at. They were here, but I don't know where they at. So the soldiers took off. She told them, man, they went that way. They went to the woods or something. Why don't you go look that way? So when the soldiers took off chasing after them, they looked everywhere for them. The two spies that she hid. When they were gone, she called the two spies. She said, hey, listen, look, I know that the Lord has given you the land. That's faith, right? And I know that your terror is falling upon us. And I know that all the inhabitants, everybody in this land is gonna die because of you. I know that, faith. Because we heard about what your God did to the Egyptians. Now, therefore, I beg you, I'm begging you, I want you to swear to me. I want you to swear to me by God, since I've shown you kindness, that you will also show me kindness in my father's house. And I want you to give me something. Give me a true token. Give me some physical proof that you'll remember me when y'all come back to conquer this land. In verse 13, she says, and this is what I'm asking you to do, because I did something for you. I did something for God's people. I want you to save alive my father, my mother, all my brothers and sisters, and everything that they got. And I want you to deliver us from death. I want to make sure that we all live, just me and my family. This woman sold out her own people. She sold out her entire nation. She's a turncoat. She's a traitor. And she's a prostitute. You sell out your own people just to save yourself? Well, it's in God's divine plan anyway. There's nothing she can do about it. All right, so we move forward, and Joshua, he's rallying up the troops. He's getting everybody together, and he's giving his troops the battle cry, but he's giving them the specific instructions as they're getting their load out. They're loading up their guns. They're ready to go. Tell me if you think these instructions that he gave the troops is difficult. Tell me if this is hard for you. In verse 17, he says, in the city shall be cursed, all of it, and all that are in it, all cursed to the Lord. Only Rahab, the harlot, in case you was wondering which Rahab, only Rahab, the prostitute, shall live. She and all that are within her house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. See, she didn't just believe, she did something. It was her works that's going to get them to do something to save her. Joshua said, you'll know which house is hers because we told her to hang a red scarf out the window. When you get to that house, don't burn that house down. When you get to that house, get her, get everybody in her house and get them out, because we made a promise to her and we're going to keep our word. So once again, we're on our way there. Joshua stops everybody. He reiterates. He's telling you again. And listen, y'all, in any way, in any wise, do not make sure you keep yourselves from the cursed thing, lest you make yourselves cursed when you take of the cursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. What's the instructions? Very easy. And it's very similar to the instructions Adam had. Remember Adam, his instructions, don't eat from that tree. Okay, he's telling them the same thing. Don't take anything from this city or you will curse Israel, including yourself. Easy, basic instructions. Don't take anything. Simple as that. This is where Joshua marched around the city 7 times. Remember that? Marched around the city 7 times. They blew the trumpets. The walls of the city fell down. God made that happen. They followed God's instructions, and God took the walls down. Joshua went in. He killed everybody and everything. He burned the city down to the ground. And Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive and her father's house and all that she had. Kept his word. After this major victory, Joshua is doing the same thing again. He's sending spies out again. He's sending them out to go gather some intel. The next city he's going to conquer by the power of God was Ai. So he sent 2 spies out to the city called Ai. In verse 3, they came back. The 2 spies came back. They were smarter this time. They knew how to make sure the king didn't see them. And he said, yo, we're not going to need near the army that we used last time. We don't need the entire army. We're about to catch these jokers lacking, okay? It's not even a lot of them. We only need about 2,000-3,000 men this time. When you get to verse 5, the Israelites suffered defeat. So Joshua went from a flawless victory to suffering a loss. How? God is with us, right? We have the Ark of the Covenant. How are Israelites dying at war against such a small army? We sent more than we needed. He said about 2,000-3,000. We sent 3,000. And we got defeated? We've defeated Jericho with no problem. The wall just came down. We blew trumpets. And now we're defeated? The Bible says, and the men of Ai smote them, 36 men. They chased them from before the gate, even to Shibarim, and smote them in the going down. This is why the hearts of the people melted and became as water. Why did we lose? Why did people have to die? Do you remember the specific instruction Joshua gave them before he went into the city? Do you remember exactly what he said? It was simple. But Israel sinned. There is sin in the camp. God said, and they have also broken my covenant. Can you believe that there is sin in covenant servants? The Lord said, there is sin in our camp. This camp, the one you're watching. There's sin here. There's a covenant servant living and practicing sin, and you're holding all of us back. You're jeopardizing the entire camp, and you're putting all of us in danger. God said the Israelites have broken my commandments and have stolen a cursed thing. They think they're slick. They dissembled it. They broke it down, and they hid it. They packaged sin in a way that they think they can get away with it. If I just do this, then it'll be all right, rather than just following the commandments. They lost the war in Ai because they sinned in Jericho. They lost the war here because they sinned over there. You got problems today because you sinned. Talk to me. What am I going to say? Because you sinned before today, yesterday. He told them before they went in the city, don't take anything you're not supposed to take. And you should know better anyway not to be fooling with idols. What is wrong with them? Why are you doing this? Why didn't you just listen? You mean to tell me we lost the war because of that? So you sin and it affects other people? Yes. Your secondhand smoke affects other people. Your substance abuse affects other people. Your lies affects other people. Your rage and your lust affects people. Yes, your sin. The sin that made you happy, the sin that made you feel good, it destroys other people's lives. Yes, it matters what you do. When we get to Amos 8, verse 11, it says, behold, that means pay attention. The days are coming, said the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. I'm going to read that again. Make sure y'all catch it. Did y'all hear what I said? The Bible says, pay attention. There's a day going to come when people won't hear the words of the Lord. God says there will be a time when his own people won't hear the word of God. Preachers can preach till their throat fall out and people are hardening their hearts. Can you imagine? God can send signs and messages and people will ignore it. There will be a time when people don't want to hear God telling them to stop sinning. Think that's now? Do you think that's going on today? Paul asked a poignant question. What shall we say then? Then what? After you've heard the word of God. That's it. After you've heard the word of God, after you've been given instructions of what not to do, what shall we say? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin continue to live in sin? And that's the job of a real preacher. I'm not a motivational speaker. I'm not a cheerleader or a life coach. A real pastor has a duty in this word famine that we live in today. God gave instructions to all real preachers. He said, cry loud, spare not. Don't hold back nothing. Don't be afraid of their faces. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Okay, God. All right. I got you. What do you want me to lift up my voice and say? He said, show my people their transgressions. In the house of Jacob, show them their sins. That's what the Bible says. That's the instructions that a pastor has to keep. Here, Joshua is upset. Joshua is saying, everybody going to hear that we just lost this war. Everybody going to hear that we've been defeated, and then they're going to want to come and try us. He goes to God and he laments, Lord, once the Canaanites hear about this, they're going to surround us and they're going to kill all of us. Hey, Joshua, there's sin in the camp. You crying, you complaining about the consequences, but the sin hasn't been burned with fire. Help us, Lord. You're praying for God to move the consequence, and God not trying to hear that. God responded to Joshua, Israel sinned. Get up and shut up. Why are you praying when there's sin in the camp? God said, what are you laying on your face like that for? What's your plan to deal with sin? Your morality versus God's laws. What you think is okay versus what God has already said. Do you think you get to decide whatever thing or whether or not God is going to accept your behavior? You think you can make up an excuse and God has to accept it? He's thinking, well, yes, it's an idol, but it's not an erect idol. I'm not bowing down to it. I mean, I broke it down. It's tucked away. What's the big deal? It don't take all that. You ever heard that? I don't have to stop doing anything. All I got to do is believe, right? God said, these are some scary words. God said, I'm not going to be with you. I'm not going to be with you anymore until you destroy the cursed thing from among you. Would you be able to live a single day with God saying, don't even waste your time praying? Could you handle that? God said, when calamity hits, I'm not going to be with you until you destroy the sin. That's the Bible. That's in your Bible. God said, get up, Joshua, sanctify the people, and say, sanctify yourselves against tomorrow. For this said the Lord God of Israel, there's a cursed thing in the midst of you, O Israel. You cannot stand before your enemies until you take away the cursed thing from among you. God ain't gonna move until you move. You have a cursed thing. You have a cursed person. I want God to put a relationship together for me. I want God to pick my job. I want God to pick where I live. I don't want to be cursed. I don't want to have financial problems and sickness and depression to be my enemy and then God turn his back on me. Whatever it is, God, take it away. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what the pain, God, separate me. Rip it out. Anything that doesn't please you, God, anything that's not like you, God, I give you full permission and authority. Take it away from me. Take it away from my family. Take it away from my kids. Whatever it costs, Lord. Whatever it costs them, Jesus, if you have to blind them, if you have to cripple them, God, do whatever you got to do so that we're saved and so that we please you. Is there anybody here like that? Is there anybody here? Look at me. Is there anybody here that just want to be right? I just want to be right. Is there anybody here that's tired of unnecessary consequences? Thank you, Jesus. What does it mean to continue in sin and continue to have consequences and continue to pray about the consequences and do nothing about the sin in the camp? You're thinking, why does nothing seem to work? Why do I keep getting my heart broken? Why can I never get a break? I'm smart enough to know the problem is sin, but I can't seem to stop. I was born like this. So I got to continue doing this, right? That's why Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. When you know better, you do better. Let me rephrase that. When you know better, you're supposed to do better. The Bible says, marvel not. That means don't even question it. You must be. You gotta be. You better be born again. There's a problem with your entrance into this world. And the time you spend here is temporary. In a relatively few years, few short years that you have here, you got to purify your heart. You got to have clean hands. That means you got to stop living a life practicing sin. You got to have a pure heart. That means you got to be born again. Thank you, Jesus. What does it mean to take up your cross? What does it mean to be dead to sin? What does it mean to be buried with Christ? What does it mean to walk in the newness of life? What does it mean to be a new creature? Romans 6:3, don't you know that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ? Those of us that got baptized, we were baptized into his death. That's what baptism is. Death? Yes, you're dying and you're being buried. The water is a symbol of being buried in the ground. What do you mean buried? Because you're burying the old you so the new you can get up. You're burying the old sinful nature that you had. You're burying the old person that used to sin and continue to sin and not stop sinning. That person has to die, and you got to kill him. You got to kill her. And then you have to be buried. And when you get up, you have to live a new life and don't practice the sin that you practiced before. Verse 4 says, because of that, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we shall also walk in a new life. When you get baptized, you're supposed to leave the old life in the water and walk in a born again life. You can't get salvation without qualification. You got to be born again. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, listen very carefully to what I'm about to say. Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. You got to be born again. That's not optional. Jesus said the same exact thing twice. In John 3, verse 3, he says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. What does that mean? In Matthew 19, and behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing, not just believe, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? What do I have to do to live forever? What do I have to do to reign with you, God? You know, this is the oldest sought after desire of man since Adam. How do I live now that I have to die? That's the most sought after question. How do I continue to live even though I have an appointment with death? And he said unto him, he's answering this question. You want to know how does he go to heaven? He want to know how does he live forever? He says, if you want to enter into life, eternal life, keep the commandments. Very simple instructions. This is the Lord himself telling you what you have to do to get eternal life. Stop listening to anybody that ever tells you don't have to keep the commandments. Jesus himself is telling you what you got to do to get eternal life. And why is he bringing up these old commandments? Because you got to keep them. We had a lawyer try to be slick. In Luke, he says, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, trying to be slick, trying to trap him, saying, master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said unto him, what's written in the law? How you read that? You're a lawyer. You're supposed to know the law. Why is Jesus referring back to the law? Back to the rules, back to the commandments. Let's see what's in the law. Let's see what law Jesus is talking about. In the last book that Moses wrote, if you return unto the Lord your God, watch this, and shall obey his voice, what's his voice, his word, according to all that I command you this day, and your children, because your sins affect other people. It says, with all thine heart, that's how you purify your heart. And with all your soul, it's time for us to get up out of our sleep and return to God. This is a message directly to you from God. Then that then the Lord thy God will turn your captivity. He'll switch our captivity and have compassion upon you and will gather you, and will return and gather you from all the nations where the Lord thy God hath scattered you. Listen, if you don't get rid of the sin in the camp, you're holding us all back. That's the whole point of this message. You got to get the sin out of the camp. Verse 5, and the Lord thy God will bring thee into the land which your fathers possessed, and you're going to possess it. And he, I like this, he will do thee good. Ooh, I like the way that sounds. Oh my gosh. God said, I'm going to do you good. What does it mean to have the creator of the world, the supreme being, God Almighty said, I will do you good. Oh, I'll do anything for that. I'll do anything and give up anything for God to do me good. If I'm never sick again, that's good. If I never have to experience heartache again, that's good. If I never have to experience going to a funeral or going to a morgue to identify a body, that's good. That's what I want. If all my life problems go away, that's good. This is what God promises us. If your enemies be at peace, if you won't be depressed no more, that's good. Why don't you want this? This is what God is offering you. He said, I'll do you good. If I finally make it into the presence of God, that's good. Thank you, Jesus. If I make it to see his face in peace, that's good. That's what I want. What would it take to get somebody interested in God doing them good? What would it take for you to say, this is what my goal in this life is. This is what I want to do. This is what I want to spend my time tonight and tomorrow. This is what I want to focus on, getting God to do me good. I want to be in that place where God is doing me good. Revelation 22:14, blessed are they that do his commandments. This is the last book. Blessed are they that do what? That keep his commandments. Because these people are going to, they're going to have the right to the tree of life. You know, the tree that Adam wasn't supposed to eat from? You're going to have the right to it and may enter in through the gates into the city. That's good. God is doing you good. That's why I'm going to keep these commandments. I'm going to obey his voice. If I have to do it all by myself, if I have to swim against the current, if I have to fight against the crowd, I'm going to keep these commandments. The Bible says enter in at the straight gate. Thank you. Because this ain't for everybody. It's a straight gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. The broad and wide way is going along with everybody else, doing what everybody else is doing. God said, no, my way is a straight and narrow way. My way is you giving up some stuff. My way is you sacrificing some things. My way is you saying, well, I'd rather please God, even if I'm wrong. And a whole bunch of people that's going into the pathway of destruction. Oh, man, thank you, Jesus. Help us, Lord. You want to know what you got to do? Glad you asked. You want to know what you got to do to be saved? You want to know what you got to do to get eternal life? You want to know what you got to do to be born again? Here are the instructions from God through me for the rest of your life. You follow these instructions, you'll have eternal life. Ecclesiastes 7:1 says, do no evil, so no harm shall come upon you. Verse 2, depart from the unjust. What does that mean? I mean, stop hanging with sinners. And it says, and sin shall turn away from you. Bind not one sin upon another, for in one you shall not be unpunished. You're going to be punished for every sin. Verse 16 says, this is reiterating what he just said. Number not thyself among the multitude of sinners, but remember that wrath will not tarry long. God is coming back. Get on the narrow path. God is coming back. Get on the straight and narrow. In a few short days, listen to my voice. In a couple days, God will be here. We got to wake up. Romans 13:11, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of our sleep. It's time to wake up. For now is salvation nearer than we believed. Don't you feel it? You're watching the news. Don't you see something is happening? Something is going on. Your spirit ought to be stirring up. We need to wake up. This is the time when our salvation is nearer than we believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us do something different. When you know better, you're supposed to do better. When you hear God's word, it's supposed to challenge your heart and you're supposed to say, yes, Lord. Yes, I'm going to obey. Let us behave decently as people who live in the light of day. not in partying and drunkenness, not being lewd and wilding out, not in fighting or jealousy, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. It means go get filled with the Holy Ghost and make none provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts of your flesh. Joshua needs to find this thing. He got to find this thing quick. He needs to find this sin that's in the camp. What a job a preacher has. Because people are going to get mad. People don't want to hear, you got to get right. They want to be inspired. They want to hear smooth things. You want to hear a prosperity message when God is coming back to destroy the prosperity? You want to hear a message about getting houses and cars? God is coming back without mercy? Joshua said, I need to find that thing that has angered my God. No rock unturned. Dump everybody's bag out. Empty out your pockets. Whatever the sin is, big or small, we're not going to rest till we find it. And that's your job today. Find the sin. And that includes me. Search me, O Lord. Search me, God. And make it plain. Show me my errors. Show me exactly what I need to adjust. Show me what I need to stop doing. And I promise you, God, because I love you so much and I want to please you, I'll stop it immediately. Thank you, Jesus. I want everybody that's listening to me. You know exactly what I'm talking about. So don't try to rationalize it. Don't try to make it okay. You've been doing it so long, you got comfortable with it. You got an excuse for it, but you ain't got no plan to stop it. God said, it's time. It's time. I need you to find it, confess it to God, and destroy it, and never do it again. And it shall be, in case you think God playing with sin, when you find out the person that has the cursed thing, he shall be burnt with fire. He, not just him, and all his stuff. We got to burn all your stuff because he has broken the covenant of the Lord and because he has brought foolishness into Israel. It's foolish to sin. It's foolish to disobey God. Lost a war. People died. You got people killed. What heaven you going to with sin? God wants to help you. He wants to see you with a purified heart. You're not weak. You can stop doing anything you started. You cannot do anything you do do. You cannot do anything that you do do. You cannot do, you can stop doing anything that you're doing. So get up from here and go burn your sin. Burn it with fire so you don't have to deal with it no more. What does that mean? That means you got to change your environment. That means you got to delete some numbers. That means you got to uninstall some apps. That means you got to hang up the phone. That means you got to stop talking to certain people. You might end up having to have lunch by yourself. You might have to catch the bus home and not get a ride anymore. You got to burn it with fire. Get the sin out of the camp, keeping us all back. And Achan answered Joshua. He went and he interviewed everybody. We up all night. Nobody's going to bed. Nobody's going to rest till we find out what the sin is. Found out it was Achan. And he said, it was me. Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel. And thus have I done. Confess, I did it. Yeah, I disobeyed. Yeah, I brought sin into the camp. Yeah, I got all of us cursed. Yeah, the war was lost. It's my fault. I got an idol. It's broken down under a rug. It's in my house. Whatever your sin is, you hiding it or you might be displaying it. You think God is not seeing it? Do you think God is pleased? Do you think God is just going to say, don't worry about it? And Joshua said, why did you do this? Why have you troubled us? Okay. The Lord going to trouble you today. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they stoned him with stones. You want to know what's under those rocks? You want to know what's in the Valley of Achor? A dude named Achor. This is here today. You can Google it. He's there now. This is God saying, I'm not playing. I'm so glad God has grace. I'm so glad God is giving us a space of time to get it right. I'm so glad God loves us so much that not only would he die for us, but he's offering you a chance to get forgiveness. God will forgive you for every sin you committed. Why not get forgiveness? Why try to carry your sins into eternity when God will forgive you for it? What are you going to do? And if it seems evil unto you, Joshua said, to serve the Lord. Choose this day. He's letting you know, we're not dealing with this no more. You got to make a choice. Choose who you're going to serve. Are you going to serve the gods which your father served on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean? Or the gods of the Amorites in whose land we dwelt when you lived in Africa? But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. This household, this camp, covenant servants are going to serve the Lord. I'm sorry if you thought you can join this camp and you can live any kind of way and do any kind of thing. I'm sorry if you thought you can stay here and you can remain a part of this ministry and continue in sin. I'm sorry that you thought that. I never told you that. We are going to serve the Lord. That's what we're going to do. We have to continue to serve the Lord because God is coming back. God is coming back with open arms and he's ready to receive you into his kingdom. What are you going to do? You can be delivered and you won't have to sell your people out. You can be delivered and you won't be called by your sin. From the day you were born until the time God comes back, you can get rid of all the sin in between. All you gotta do is talk to him. Talk to him about it. Romans 6 and 22 says, but now being made free from sin. You can be made free from sin. If you become free from sin and become servants to God, the Bible says you have your proof unto holiness. And in the end, when it's all over, you'll have everlasting life. Thank you, Jesus. That's what I want. Does anybody want everlasting life? Everlasting life is precious. Everlasting life is precious. It's not just something that God is just going to give away. You're going to have to make sacrifices for it. You're going to have to go down the straight and narrow path. What are you willing to give up? And think about the things that you're not willing to give up. Is it worth it? Is it worth retaining that sin within your own self and within your camp? It's time to give God one full chance at him leading you and guiding you. It's time to surrender to him. It's time to give up every single sin in your life. It's time for you to say no to sin. It's time for you to surrender and say, God, I'll serve you. I'll serve you, God. Thank you, Jesus. I'll do it, God. If no one else will do it, God, I'll do it, Jesus. I'll serve you, Lord. And I'll say yes. This is how you serve God. This is how you do it. You just say yes. I'll obey your word. I'll obey your way. I'll do what you say, God. Thank you, Jesus.